3 days ago, the Geneva-based World Health Organization issued a report about clusters of a yet unknown virus
could soon develop into an epidemic of major proportions. The situation across Middle and South America is deteriorating rapidly. Virulent turmoil in cities throughout Brazil have led to the death of at least 197 people. I want to be very clear. We have to take it very serious.
Prepare for the worst and hope for the best.
In the long term, everybody will die.
We need to act rapidly and all together.
We are tired of giving all the same advice over and over and over again.
In the last pandemic, they were absolutely useless. Useless.
People get quite quickly bored of classical conferences, especially after 1.5 years of Zoom conferences. We have to deal with new questions in new formats. We are here at the Como Lake in northern Italy, in the Villa La Collina, the training center of Konrad Adenauer Stiftung. We will do a simulation about a pandemic with a high lethality. It's called SARS-5, starting in 2024. It's the first time for us. It's the first time for most participants. And we will see and find out what will be the outcome.
Eye-opening.
Highly valuable.
So educative.
It's more than just a game. It is a very important exercise. Combine experiences from other parts of the world.
To meet people face to face, and the networking that you could do is the great thing about this kind of exercise.
We can learn a lot from this kind of simulations.
We developed a future scenario where we put a new SARS-CoV pathogen into the game, which kills 20% of infected people. And to deal with that means you have to deal with public security, not only with public health issues. So we assembled groups to look into what kind of ramifications such a game, such a scenario would have in the realm of economic continuity, public health systems, but also safety, public safety, and international cooperation.
We are doing this simulation in order to increase the preparedness of international participants here. They are multipliers and decision makers within their working field, and we would like to increase their abilities to strengthen preparedness on an international level.
Having people with different minds, different perspectives, and probably have opposite views is the prerequisite for strategy development and thinking anew afresh. So this is why we have assembled 20 people from 4 continents and 9 different countries.
Physicians, experts on pandemics. We needed military security, but we also needed politicians. We needed journalists. All those people who are involved in a pandemic if it comes to an outbreak.
Hi, my name is María Ángeles Muñoz. I'm working as the director of a new school in governance and leadership. I came from Spain, Madrid.
Hi, my name is Oscar Palma. I'm currently a professor of international relations and security studies at Universidad del Rosario, and I come from Colombia.
Hello, my name is Muneh Benjbara. I'm a physician, medical doctor. I'm professor of neurology in Medical School of Tunis and health consultant, and I'm from Tunisia.
Hi, my name is Eberhard Sandschneider. I'm a political scientist. I'm coming from Berlin in Germany.
I am Adriana Amado from Argentina.
Hello, my name is James Chikwati. I'm from Nairobi, Kenya, and I'm the founder director of the Interregion Economic Network.
Hello, my name is Ruben Moreno. I'm senator and I'm from Spain.
We ran that simulation a couple of times, 3 times all together. The first day We assembled groups from 20 countries to look into the consequences of a highly lethal game, politically, socially, public health, internationally. The second day, we asked them to play their country teams, 9 different countries from across the world, 4 continents, and they contemplated about solutions in the highly lethal pandemic. The third day, we used a dynamic model, a computer model, to look into the crisis, and they adjusted their policies and came up with solutions to save the world, basically, from that pandemic and to readjust the international cooperation system.
I was first thinking about solutions to the pandemic, as pretty much every other citizen would do. And then I had to assume the role of the Colombian government and to think what possible solutions we can implement in terms of a new pandemic coming on.
We are going to set first preliminary measures. For instance, the wear face masks. Putting mask is for free. I mean, yes, it's not going to create any additional problem.
We will convince the American public that our American science will save us. In order to do that, we need to have unity, solidarity, and some common sacrifice for a common good.
Then we will start with a limited lockdown in schools and workplaces. That will be after a couple of weeks from the measure about the mask.
So restrictions will have to be applied to travelers from maybe Europe, maybe from the US.
Germany has the capacities to deal with a lockdown even now, again. And so we decided to, in order to save the lives, to implement this very strict measure.
First, with the assumption that you know nothing about that virus, but you have to act once you detect it. Running a scenario where you want to try to keep in balance, keeping up the public life, saving lives, and don't ruin your political credibility was the first run. And it showed after the first round that you cannot persist that kind of course because it will lead to millions and millions of deaths.
This is the only solution.
This is the only solution. Okay.
But
that is
in theory, but in practice it's impossible. Because the dilemma is, you know, one path leads to the starvation and the other path
to death.
Lead to annihilation. So in the last pandemic, also Colombia and Argentina had similar results. So it's a very interesting opportunity to exchange experiences and impressions with the Colombian group.
I was supposed to represent China as one of the countries which has been dealing with COVID-19 pretty successfully. And of course, we wanted to contribute China's lessons to finding the next solution for an upcoming potential pandemic.
Regarding international cooperation between different institutions, we need to reinforce what we already learned during the last pandemic. And this is going to be a tougher situation, which will require the collaboration of all the institutions, at the European level, of course, but as well as a global level.
As we get more data from across the world, the WHO now assumes that an average 65% of people who catch the virus actually get sick. 40% of them need to be hospitalized. 60% of them need to be treated in intense care units. What makes these findings even worse is the fact that the virus is more aggressive than the 2019 coronavirus.
Then we put in more information and we unfolded the characteristics of the virus, and people were informed that the virus is much more contagious, much more dangerous, spreads more rapidly than we know it from SARS-CoV-2, which is the COVID virus. Hence, people had more information they can rely on, and we simulated a model where they can anticipate how the extrapolation and the growth of that pandemic would run over the course of 4 months. And you can see, if you don't do nothing, that the body count would be in the 100 millions globally. So knowing that extra information, they reiterated the game in the second round and came up with measures and institutional setups to cope with the situation, and they were all able to somehow save their lives, keep up the economies, and do not ruin the political systems and the trust in their political leaders.
To make a common effort in order to maintain our unity around our position in coordination with the European Union. But as a country, we need to act together, follow the new rules in order to maintain our stability.
Regional cooperation seems like a necessary step to advance in the solutions to the pandemic.
The distribution of vaccines, where we clearly saw and documented a conflict from the global south versus the global north.
Tunisian scientists immigrate to work in that big American or European labs, and we will be able to find the cure and the vaccine in 2 months and test it in 3 months. I assume also that big states will free license the data so we can manufacture it locally in Africa.
The principle upon with which we would operate would be competition, not cooperation. We believe that only competition leads to progress. You can see that in vaccine development. Speed is of the essence.
In the third round, we had the discussion about what is necessary today if you want to cope with a situation like this in the future, in the realm of international cooperation, the multilateral system, the role of nation states, the role of international actors like the European Union or the African Union. And we came to very, very insightful conclusions about which kind of order we are in, the world we're facing due to international competition, and what we need to do to adjust this kind of system to survive a crisis like this.
There is no direct necessary connection between the type of political system and the values it's based on and the efficiency of handling crisis.
From my point of view, at least in Spain, you shouldn't take any action unless it's discussed previously among the member states in the ECDC. You could do it. I fully not recommend that unless you are in panic.
The countries were really uncomfortable about the delay that everything that the European Union does creates.
In essence, the outcome of the game was threefold. The international system is not ready to cope with the situation. Second, nation states play a crucial role in bringing alliances together. And third, we need regional actors like the European Union as platforms to serve as innovators for others.
Maybe it's not so much the Konrad Adenauer Foundation who has to learn from this. It's first of all participants who are serving as multiplicators, going back home, giving these informations to their organizations, to their governments.
I think the biggest lesson for me is empathy. I now empathize with anybody who calls himself or herself a leader in any country.
Probably you understand the decision they made before. And I criticize as a journalist most of the times.
And you learn a lot from, for example, people in the context of medicine on viruses and all these kind of things.
Time is a crucial factor in fighting pandemics. And when COVID-19 broke out, we all started thinking, what could we do? Now we are preparing in these simulation exercises what could be done in a second, another case in the future.
The bottom line is that we now have to do our homework to be better prepared for a pandemic, which will come in the years to come. This is certain.
Maybe even one day. And we know all these days will come. In another pandemic, in a maybe more dangerous pandemic, they will network even stronger to find better ways and to support the governments.